Let me go ahead and talk about one more potential cause of structural unemployment. And that's going to be the idea of efficiency wages. So the idea of an efficiency wage is the employer voluntarily pays wage above competitive equilibrium. And why would they do this? They do this because somehow that's actually cheaper, all things considered, than paying people that lower wage. And could be that this comes from a couple of different effects. In a really low-income economy, you might see that if we pay people a higher wage, they have better nutrition, and with better nutrition, they're able to work more efficiently because they have more energy and so on and so forth. In the U.S. economy, I'm pretty sure that's not a likely consideration since most of us are pretty overweight as it is. But in a third world economy, that could go ahead and be important. Could be something like we're going to go ahead and reduce turnover. If I pay higher wages, then people are less likely to quit. It could be that I want to attract a large pool of applicants. So I want to make sure I have a large pool of qualified applicants so that I can pick and choose. And it could be a mixture of all these things. I want to go ahead and just briefly explain kind of the dynamics of how this might work. And the story I'm going to tell has to do with a reduction in monitoring costs. So monitoring and supervising workers is expensive because you have to hire the manager to go out there and watch the workers. And if the labor market has everyone paying this competitive equilibrium wage, then the unemployment rate is zero. So equilibrium wage, that is a wage where quantity demanded of labor and quantity supplied of labor are equal, is going to go ahead and produce a 0% unemployment rate. Because remember, unemployment is a mismatch between quantity demanded and quantity supplied. Now, if the unemployment rate is zero, and all employers are paying the same wage, then how much do I care if you fire me? And the answer is not very much, because the unemployment rate's zero, and I just walk next door to the next place down, and they hire me. So that's going to lead to nobody doing much work. And employers are going to have to invest a lot of energy in supervising people. They're going to have to supervise people pretty much all the time, and that's going to be expensive. So what if an employer decides to voluntarily pay a higher than equilibrium wage? Now, I look at this and I go, well, if I lose my job here making, say, $10 an hour, the employer is going to voluntarily say, I'm going to pay you $12 an hour. Now if I lose my job, it may be true that unemployment is still pretty low, but when I walk down the street to get a job at the next place, they're only paying $10 an hour, and so that gives me a significant incentive to not lose my job. Of course, all the other employers are also reacting the same way, so we get employers voluntarily paying this above equilibrium wage. And again, we get in a situation where we have the quantity of labor demanded is less than the quantity of labor supplied, and we get some level of unemployment. So both the fact that although we end up with all the employers paying a very similar wage, they all pay this efficiency wage, and then it's the fact that, oh, if I lose my job, I'll be out of work for a while and I'll miss some income. That's going to be my incentive here. Now, of course, some workers have internal motivation to do their work, and some workers don't. So we're put in less geeky terms. Some people are hardworking and some people aren't. And it might be that things like culture make a difference here. So if we have a situation like Japan, where maybe it's considered very shameful to be out of work, then in addition to the actual lost income, there's sort of a social stigma of being out of work. So it may take less of an efficiency wage to motivate people to work hard, and so the efficiency wage may be closer to the market equilibrium, so we'll have less unemployment. And maybe in some other country out there, there isn't that stigma attached to being unemployed. In that case, if there's no stigma, you're going to have to push the wage higher above the competitive equilibrium and create a larger amount of unemployment before you're going to motivate people as much. So potentially this efficiency wage can explain some things about cross-national or international differences in unemployment. We also see that in general, some countries out there are going to have higher minimum wages relative to others. They're going to have stronger or weaker unions, and they might have, say for instance, burdens on hiring and firing, which is not something I talked about explicitly, but essentially some countries make it so that when you fire someone, you have to pay them a large amount of severance. And if firms, in the short run, that may cause firms to fire fewer people, and that may reduce the unemployment rate. In the longer run, firms are now going to become pretty reluctant to hire people because they know they might have to pay out a lot of money if they let them go. And also, potentially, if workers know that there's a penalty to be paid for firing them, they may be less motivated, and that may be contributing to our efficiency wage situation there. And before I finish up, notice that the efficiency wage, it sort of sounds pretty awesome in some ways from the point of view of the workers, right? Efficiency wage means we get a higher wage than the market equilibrium. And that is good, at least for workers. But notice that as we depart from the market equilibrium, we are going to have, again, both some unemployment and we're going to have some deadweight loss here. So the efficiency wage is itself a response to a market failure. And the particular type of market failure here is what's called asymmetric information. And asymmetric information means that one of the people in the transaction knows more than the other. So you know whether or not you slacked off, and your supervisor or boss maybe doesn't. And so this, in particular, is one species of asymmetric information known as the principal agent problem. And if you've taken sort of business law, you'll have recognized some of these terms here. So the principal is the person with decision-making rights and the person whose interests are supposed to be represented here. The agent is who they hire to act on their behalf. But of course, a lot of times, the principal has a hard time knowing whether or not the agent is actually acting in their best interest. And notice this sort of problem of principals and agents is really, really common out there in society and the economy. Of course, we have voters who have the right to elect politicians, but it's hard to monitor our politicians and know whether or not they're actually acting in our best interest. Politicians make rules and establish government agencies, and so they're going to be trying to figure out whether the bureaucrats are actually acting in their interests in the way that they've commanded. We have shareholders, and we have CEOs and corporate boards. We have the corporate leadership and the lower level employees. So these principal agent problems are really, really common out there in the economy. And, you know, within the bureaucrats, then we'd have the senior bureaucrats versus trying to monitor and track what's going on with the junior bureaucrats. So this is sort of something that is almost an inescapable feature of human interaction here. And it sort of points out here that, you know, we have a problem. There's a market failure here. There's this asymmetric information. And there is a kind of workaround through the efficiency wage. But that workaround has its own issues. And it's not clear whether any better workaround can be designed. You know, so obviously, you know, we have these problems infesting the political sector and the private sector both. So, you know, neither sector of the economy seems to really have solved these problems. And sometimes we just have to kind of go, all right, let's try and make this problem as less severe or as minimal as possible. And sometimes that's the best we can hope for.